سلموا تسليما.
الدار اللي يصير whenever I leave the house
جنة
and on whatever thing my eyes fall on.
وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما. صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة
صبر.
ونعيما.
الله تعالى سيد والله يحب الصابرين. الله تعالى اسلف بعد الكلمة.
School governing body of South Coast Madrasa.
أبصارها
وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما. صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى
critical importance of understanding the very specific or localized causes of poverty and suffering at the grassroots level, and why such understanding and dialogue is central to implementing effective strategies and aid programs. As an organization that works closely with both our benefactors and our rights holders, we are acutely aware of the complexities and nuances in dealing with human aid work. We are firm proponents of developing sustainable locally initiated projects. Projects that will contribute to not only the upliftment of communities and persons in need, but also that we support innovative projects that will help and enhance and maintain the dignity and values of the communities that we serve. We are also aware that for sustainability and effectiveness in delivering aid, local communities require voices in any global plan or macro level strategy. And therefore, this is considered fundamental. And it is to this end that we are honored to co-host this grassroots consultative process for the Southern and Eastern African regions in leading up to the UN convened World Humanitarian Summit. I trust that this conference will provide the necessary dialogue space for meaningful engagements and consultations. I therefore officially and warmly welcome all of you, and may each of you be embraced in with the true spirit of our South African hospitality. And that is perfectly captured in our local tradition of Ubuntu. Togetherness in humanity and forward together for humanity. Thank you and welcome to everyone.
Thank you very much, Yusuf. Thank you very much for your words introducing the conference. I'd like now to introduce our second speaker, Dr. Haniel Bunna. He's the president of the Humanitarian Forum. He's also been a very active humanitarian in different positions. He was actually CEO of Islamic Relief as well in previous years. So somebody with an enormous amount of experience, somebody who's dedicated to building partnerships and bringing about real change through discussions and those partnerships. So again, if you could show your warm welcome to Dr. Haniel Bunna.
We came here for the community. Can my schoolmate come next to me, please? A schoolmate. Because we are in the same school, the same year, studying the same subjects, isn't right? We play rugby. You play rugby. We came here for the community. The summit is for the community. The summit is for the grassroots. It's not for me and Ignacio and Amran. It's for you, because you are the future. You are the future of the humanity. That's why we are here for you. When we heard about the humanitarian summit, when I heard about the humanitarian summit last year from one of my colleagues from UN, I did not know what to do. But I said, okay, let us do something. This was in October last year. You were with us. Fine, thank you. So we had a meeting in Jordan in January when we invited top directors from UNWatch and New York, Ms. Queen, and she told us as a humanitarian forum to help in communicating with the local community, with the grassroots community, as well as with the national organization. Since then, Humanitarian Forum, in partnership, in a very close partnership with UN OCHA, New York, Geneva, Middle East, now, while in South Africa, organizing many national consultations. We just finished last week our 13th national consultation in Saudi Arabia. We did 4 in Africa and 9 in Middle East and North Africa. So this is our partnership with UN OCHA to talk about the future of humanity, talk about the Dream Summit. We call it the Dream Summit because the summit has been made for us as new players, as grassroots community, as yourself, as well, to talk about your dreams. And let us have your dreams on the table to enable us to be able to make your dream true.
We'll be able to do that?
All together. So today, Islamic Leaf, your Nocha, Ignacio is a good friend of mine. I'm a good friend of him. Okay. And we will have to work together. You know, the word together becomes a must. It's not a luxury anymore. Partnership becomes a necessity for life. Partnership is a necessity for life. It makes life easy. It makes people happy. And it makes problems solved as soon as we sit down together to discuss our problems. So the dreams you have at the back of your mind has to be put on the table tomorrow and after tomorrow to say that we want to lead. It's our summit. It's not UN summit. It's not Islamic Leaf summit. It's not Humanitarian Forum summit. It is our summit. Our summit as individual, our summit as community, our summit as nations, and our summit as young generation. This is a summit which I called it when we met in January this year in Jordan. It's our dream summit. We must make it happen for humanity, to save and serve humanity, because we are the servants of humanity. I cannot afford to open the officially the, what do you call it, the meeting tomorrow, before having, with your permission, your MC, sir. Can I ask Ignacio to stand next to me when I open the thingy? Thank you, Ignacio, because he is the one who was behind all these mechanics of the success of our meeting today, tomorrow, and after tomorrow. And I cannot open the ceremony, so you can be with, between me and the generation to come, or she, come this way. So we all, together, officially declaring the meeting is open today.
The meeting is officially opened today.
Therefore, we need to look the advantage of being after you, Dr. Hane. I think that everybody has said what we are expecting from that humanitarian world summit. We are not expecting to have the voices of the UN, because we saw them every day in the TV. We are not expecting to have the voices of the international NGOs. We are expecting to have the voices of those who are suffering. Every day, when I wake up, I try to look myself and to say, why you are working on the humanitarian arena? And my answer is, I am working because you have people who are suffering and people that need help of other people. But the problem is that I end my day in front of one computer. Therefore, I found a little bit contradictory that I wake up thinking in people, and at the end I finish in front of one computer. What we would like to do here is to change the computer for faces. We would like to see the faces of those who are suffering, of those who are close to those who are suffering. And we would like to listen from them, where are the solutions? And we would like to listen from them what we are doing well and what we are doing bad. And we are with the dream to listen from them what are not their needs, but what are their aspirations. What are the aspirations of the communities? I have been working as a humanitarian for the last 20 years. I never saw someone asking me to save their life. They are asking me to have a life. And I think that this meeting is about life. It's about how we can support people to have a life, a proper life. Finally, the expectations are big. And it's not only Islamic Relief, it's Oxfam, it's World Division, it's Save the Children, it's World Food Program, it's the organization, the International Organization for Migrations, is UNDP, is the international community, is everybody that is coming together to listen to you. Therefore, you have a space in these 2 days to tell us what we need to do in the future. And I hope to have a fantastic report at the end of these 2 days that will be changing the life of thousands, the lives of millions who are suffering today. My intention was to have a speech of 7 hours, but they reduced my speech to 7 minutes. Therefore, I need to finish. Thank you very much and enjoy your food.
I'm Dr. Albanna, the president of Humanitarian Forum. We're here today to see the new change, the new dynamic change that UN is making through a grassroots consultation with the local community to discuss the aims and objectives of the World Humanitarian Summit, 2016 World Humanitarian Summit. Today, we are listening to the voice of the voiceless, to the voice of the community, to the voice of the individuals, to the voice of the marginalized community, and to the voice of the needy people. It's a new change that we are seeing to make the success story of our forthcoming summit in 2016. While in South Africa, region to celebrate the beginning of the change, the first grassroots regional consultation to discuss with local community organizations from South Africa, from Zimbabwe, from Mozambique, from Mauritius, from Comoros, from Madagascar, from Zimbabwe, from Uganda, from DRC, their needs, their dreams, and their aspirations. And today and tomorrow and after tomorrow, the partnership which has been built between UN OCHA, Islamic Relief South Africa, Islamic Relief worldwide, as well as the Humanitarian Forum, is echoing to different dimensions of the local and the grassroots communities. It's the beginning of a big change. It's the beginning of a process of change, and we'll need to see the outcome and the result of it, which is effective change to impact the future of humanity and the future of our community and the future of our generation. We thank Your Nature. We thank Islamic Leaf Worldwide. We thank Islamic Leaf South Africa. And we thank Humanitarian Forum and thank all of you of coming to make this story a success story and the history in the making. We need this change because sometimes we were relying heavily on our resources as the international community, on our resources as international non-government organization, on our resources as governments, on our resources as UN agencies. And sometimes we used to ignore the voices of the voiceless. It seems nowadays that innovation is coming from them, through them, by them, and to be done by them. That's why today we have to admit that we were mistaken. We did a mistake in the past. We wasted a lot of resources, a lot of time of not listening and engaging the grassroots community with us. One of the dimensions or the themes of our summit in 2 years' time is transformation through innovation. And I believe that innovation will come from bottom up, not top down. The need is the power of innovation. What we need to add is to empower them, the local community, to engage more academia, to engage more business community, and to engage the governments. Because without governments, organization, without media, media also has to be very heavily engaged. Because of the power of media is very essential for advocacy and education to the grassroots themselves. So media, academia, business community, governments, and civil society. Partnership between this.
Yeah, my name is Imran Madan. I'm the head of the humanitarian department at Islamic Relief. Essentially, the humanitarian department is responsible for what we call the first response. So essentially, it's our job to respond to a disaster within 72 hours. It's a very strict mandate. So essentially, we have to have either, if it's a country that we work in, an operation responding, or we have to fly ourselves to a part of the world and start a response. We are part of the group of organizations that are supporting the consultation. It's the grassroots consultation process, which is all building up towards the World Humanitarian Summit in Istanbul in 2016. So, you know, it's a long way off, but this is an opportunity to start speaking to communities about how they see the process of humanitarian response. We know there's problems with it, but again, it's very easy for us to make assumptions about what's wrong. And I think this is a fantastic opportunity to get right into the sort of far distant parts of civil society at a really grassroots level, and to engage with them and to ask them about what they think about international NGOs, about how the way governments respond, how we as NGOs help them to be prepared and strong and resilient. And already some of the questionnaires indicate that there's a lot of work to be done. Some of the assumptions about problems within the system, yes, they are very much reflected in the questionnaires, but we hope to extend those questions over the next 2-3 days and allow people to tell us from their particular community, from their particular angle, what is wrong, but most essentially to tell us how we go about the process of change. I think it's important to acknowledge that everybody plays their part. I don't think communities, in spite of their criticisms of what's wrong, I don't think I hear the voice that we don't need the international community, we don't need aid workers, we don't need experts. I don't think they're saying that to us. I think what they're saying is all too often their expertise, their opinions, their view on how to make their communities stronger, that voice isn't really strong enough, and it seems that they think that the process is very mechanical. It's, you know, decisions are made in London or elsewhere, and you know, it by the time it reaches them, there's a big disconnect, and it can result in aid being inappropriate. I mean, that's the worst outcome of the lack of conversation. But I think we realize that. I think we know. I think the first thing about to change a system is to realize it's not working. And I think that was realized a few years ago. And what we call the transformative agenda, the realization that we need to engage with communities, we need to build on capacity building, we need to make those communities stronger. We need to shift the power. There's a big discussion about shifting the power. Decisions being made in the countries affected by the NGOs there, them perhaps looking at proposals for that require funding and deciding in country with local NGOs and NGOs sitting around a table making those decisions. At the moment, that doesn't happen. But the good news is that there is change, actually. And in the UK, we have something called the START Fund, British government funded. But decisions about the way that fund is allocated is now being made in the country that's affected, which I think is quite a breakthrough, and it's a really exciting opportunity for us to start changing the system. So it's a process, it will probably take 10, 15, 20 years, it's a generational thing. But I think what's really encouraging is the train is leaving, there's some momentum now taking place. And I'm very optimistic that the far distant voices will be heard and will be part of that process.
That disconnect actually affects your ability to deliver the aid, affect properly.
Absolutely. I think we're very good at getting into communities and doing a rapid needs assessment and deciding on what we need to do, and then and it being participatory. I think we've been doing that for some years, but I think the ongoing conversations about what happens after the disaster, and the preparedness being jointly agreed between us and the communities. And the idea that with any response you must have some preparedness built into it. So for example, you could include, say, 10% of any response budget that has to go to preparedness. Now, there probably is some preparedness in the community that's going on. It might be the same organisation funding the preparedness. But again, even between programmes, there's sometimes a bit of a disconnect. So I think, engaging with those communities to make sure those connections are there is beginning to happen. And again, I think over the next 5-10 years, we will see some real change. I would like to see those delegates who've arrived from many different countries, from sort of Eastern and Southern Africa, build up the confidence to say what they really feel. I think there's a chance they may come and listen, but I think what we really want is for people to say what they think is their personal view. We're looking for three things, actually: for them to say what their personal view is on the system and why it's not working, to look at the challenges, but most importantly to come up with some action points. So if we have the first two without the third, I think it will be a failure. But I'm confident that, even with a tight time schedule, we can, through the capturing the learning, make it really clear how to move on with that action plan. And that gets taken to the next conference and back to UN OCHA and beyond. So real outcomes to see, some fingerprints from today's work, tomorrow's work, on that final report and in those final actions. That would be fantastic to see.
Just finally, I don't know how you can answer this, but this seems to be a particularly trying time. I don't know if it's always trying, but it seems like there's Syria, there's Ebola,
yes,
there's the Philippines.
It is.
It all seems to be happening at once.
Yes. I mean, I think if I compare tail end of last year when I was dealing with one disaster as a humanitarian department, we're now currently dealing with eight. And I think eight's the largest number of disasters we've ever managed in one go. And it's about resources, and sometimes you feel an element of paralysis. You don't really know which one to divert resources into, and it is rather ominous. I mean, I think we have to analyse the statistics. We know in terms of climate change, those extreme climate events are increasing in frequency and effect and impact. So it's ominous. But again, I think the challenge remains the same. Some of our speakers have mentioned today these disasters have been present in communities for thousands of years. I think what the challenge is to ensure that communities are resilient enough to cope with them. So you can have a situation where a typhoon hits a community 3 or 4 times in a year, but the actual impact is minimal. That's the vision, that's the best outcome.
جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه.